The month of May has been a little bit weird for me. I've produced way fewer videos than I usually produce. However, tech news has been doing quite well, so thanks to everyone who has watched that. And while I would sometimes feel a bit down on myself for not meeting my self-imposed production goals, I've actually been feeling pretty good in terms of mental health and whatnot. So it has been nice to get a bit of a breather, especially leading into next month, which is going to be very busy with Computex coverage, and then the summer, and then I feel like things accelerate after that towards the end of the year. But I do have one more video for this month. It's Probing Paul, my monthly Q&A for May 2024.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by Thermaltake's EX series fans, featuring magnetic force connectors that can daisy chain fans together to simplify installation and cable management. CT120 EX fans feature solid all-around performance and a touch of tasteful RGB lighting. The SWAFAN EX series revolutionized case fans by adding swappable fan blades, and the TUFFAN EX Pro series sports best-in-class high static pressure for use with radiators and an aggressive all-black design. And all of them feature larger magnetic force connectors for easy wiring. For more on the EX series fans from Thermaltake, click the sponsor link in the video description. I'm going to be answering a handful of questions that were asked in the comment section of last month's Probing Paul, so if you want to ask me a question to answer next month, then leave that in the comment section down below. Also, there is a Probing Paul playlist, which is linked in the description. If you'd like to check it out, you can see all the historic times that I've been probed in the past. And I must apologize as well, because I forgot to do the Probing Paul Hall of Mirrors playlist last week. My bad. I think that's only like the second time I've done that. But I'm also going to be doing mail time, opening up a few packages, including one very important package from Merch Guy John, which is attached to a poll that's also linked in the video's description if you'd like to give me some feedback on upcoming merch ideas. But with all that said, let's check out the first question from The One Clean Hippie. There's at least one of them. What is the best part of the year to build a new gaming PC, since new products get launched all the time? A lot of people don't want to invest in new hardware only to find that a few weeks or a month later, there's newer and faster stuff that comes out. All right, so I'm gonna try to give a few segmented answers to this question, because as with so many nuanced questions, the answer is, it depends. But the one thing that I think all PC builders should just sort of get lodged in their brain at some point is the fact that there is going to be newer and faster hardware that launches at some point in the future, and that your PC, no matter how much time and money you invest into the build, will be outdated at some point. It helps to sort of accept that from the get-go, but we can use historical information to give us a better idea of when would be a good time to buy new hardware. So the most obvious answer here is going to be when there are deals and sales going on, and that is going to be just before Christmas. Typically the Black Friday time period, mid to late November, early December, is when usually there are the most deals that go up, because that is holiday shopping spending time. But one of the things I like to do with Black Friday sales, even if it's not that time of year, is to use that as a point of reference to see when parts might have hit their lowest point. So you can use websites like CamelCamelCamel or PC Part Picker to see a price history, and you can see what was the cheapest they were willing to sell this at, which is usually around the Black Friday time period. If you consider that to be the low point in terms of what they're willing to sell that product for, you can compare that to what prices currently are, and then use that to judge whether you want to spend more and buy the part now, or wait for a sale. The other thing to consider besides sales, though, is when new parts typically come out. And that's part of the reason I chose this question to answer today, is because we are literally about a week away from Computex, which is one of the events that happens every year at the beginning of June, which is very PC hardware focused. So you'll find a lot more PC hardware related launches and announcements at Computex than you will at other events, even comparing it to something like CES. So for that reason, I would say that right now, 1 week before a big event, specifically a Computex event, is not a good time to buy, because it's going to be worth your while to wait just a week or two to see what's announced, to see the prices, to see when the launch dates are going to be, and that can help you decide whether you want to maybe buy some current gen hardware that's being discounted to help clear it out before the new stuff launches, or whether you want to hold out and wait for the new stuff to launch to buy what's new and fresh and fast. Then to answer the last part of your question, is there a part of the year that is quiet as far as product launches? It's usually springtime. There are often a lot of products announced at CES in January, and then usually like February, March, April, things quiet down a bit. During that time, there might be a lot of products being developed by manufacturers, but they're not ready to be announcing them or putting them up for sale. For that, they usually wait till mid-year with something like Computex, or like summer and into fall as things start to ramp up for the holiday season. All right, I hope that helps you out, One Clean Hippie, and I like your name. Moving on. And Kalime NL says, Paul, with the current GPUs on the market, some games are generating a huge amount of frames per second. Typically, most people have a 120 to 144 hertz panel of some sorts, so the frames per second is more than the screen's refresh rate. Why does screen tearing still occur, even with G-Sync or FreeSync on? Can you tell me something more about screen tearing and how to prevent it without buying a 1000 hertz monitor? So the short answer to your question is, if you're running AMD FreeSync or NVIDIA G-Sync, and your monitor is capable of that, you shouldn't see screen tearing, like, at all. So if you are seeing that, then it's probably not enabled properly. To give a brief explanation of AMD FreeSync or NVIDIA G-Sync, which are both collectively known as variable refresh rate, or a monitor that can change the refresh rate of the monitor dynamically to match the amount of frames per second that's being output by your graphics card. The goal or the upshot of enabling variable refresh rate, FreeSync or G-Sync, is to have smooth gameplay and to eliminate both tearing and stuttering. So first off, to demonstrate tearing, and we have a graphic here to represent that, if your GPU is outputting a very high refresh rate, like say it's pushing 200 frames per second, but your monitor has a lower refresh rate than that, maybe 120 or 144 hertz. If you don't have any synchronization features enabled at all, VSync or variable refresh rate, then your monitor is going to attempt to display whatever the most recent frame is that your graphics card has sent to it, even if it's not finished displaying the frame before. And that is what leads to tearing. The upper part of this image here is from one frame, middle part is from another frame, lower part is from a third frame. Because motion happened between those frames from the video card's perspective, the images don't line up and you have a tear. Now back before variable refresh rate monitors were common, the solution to this was to enable VSync. And VSync would lock the GPU's frame rate output to the refresh rate of your monitor, which at the time was typically like 60 hertz. Now in that case, the GPU might be pushing 80 or 100 or 120 frames per second. VSync would just throw out the extra frames and only show 60 frames per second, which would result in pretty smooth gameplay. But the problem there was, if you suddenly entered a part of the game that was more difficult to render for your graphics card, and your frame rate dipped below 60 hertz, VSync's solution was to cut the frame rate in half from 60 to 30, or if it dipped below 30, it would cut it from 30 to 15. When it would do that, it would introduce inconsistency between the frame times, because basically it's halving the frame rate all of a sudden, and that would introduce a stutter, a quick hiccup. And as you're playing a game, if suddenly you have a frame that freezes on screen for just a fraction of a second longer than all the other frames, it becomes noticeable and it detracts from the gameplay experience. But fortunately now, after many years of jostling, we have variable refresh rate available as AMD FreeSync or NVIDIA G-Sync, and fortunately they've worked out their disagreements and pretty much you have cross-compatibility between both of those standards, no matter if you're using an NVIDIA graphics card with a FreeSync monitor or an AMD Radeon graphics card with a G-Sync monitor. So that's a quick explanation of how those technologies work, but again, if you're experiencing tearing while you supposedly have G-Sync or FreeSync enabled, I don't think it's enabled properly. You should either reinstall your driver or check your game settings to make sure it is actually on. Next question from HellJester8097, and this is a rebuttal to last month's probing poll where I was talking about form versus function, which got a lot of comments. A lot of people agreed with me that function is better than form and that should be your focus. But there are plenty of people who disagreed with me as well, so I brought this up as one of the responses that I found to be a very good example of how situationally, yes, investing more in the form side of the build does have benefits beyond just raw performance. So HellJester says, my daughter and I have to agree with those two commenters, the ones who said they prefer form over function. She has an i5 and an RTX 3060 and really wanted a hardline loop with pastel pink coolant. Her 1% lows in Minecraft were perfectly fine and she was interested in ray tracing for 20 minutes. So for Christmas, I didn't go buy her a new CPU or GPU. I bought bike ski and barrel water blocks and fittings and she couldn't be happier. I think what's important is not frames per second, but smiles per dollar. Saying otherwise is borderline gatekeeping. Ooh, that one stings a little bit. I don't like gatekeeping, and I certainly don't want to be accused of being a gatekeeper myself, and that's part of the reason I wanted to address this question. I think context is very important here, and I hope no one thought that I was saying that this is the only way to do things because this is how I recommend doing things. My focus last month was water cooling and whether you should use water cooling or air cooling and what is more practical. However, because PC building is very personal and very DIY and very customizable to what you want to build, I don't think anyone should be throwing out ideas just because some curmudgeonly old PC builder like me came and said, no, you should only use air cooling all the time. Apart from the excitement and enthusiasm factor of custom building something and making it look really cool with a custom loop, for example, which is absolutely a very good reason to introduce someone to something like this, especially if they see a lot of artistry in that. But there are also totally practical reasons to go with a liquid cooling setup over air cooling. Small form factor builds is one that definitely stands out in my mind. And that was another comment that I got from quite a few of the responses last month. So if I may re-summarize my stance on this, it is that people who are building should be informed of the pros and cons of the cooling methods that they're going for so that they can make a choice that suits their budget, that suits their aesthetic tastes, and whatever the end result of that decision is based on the assessment of that good information that hopefully you're getting on my channel as well as others. The final answer should never be there's only one way to do things and that you're doing it wrong if you're doing it in another way. But hell, Jester, since I have a daughter myself and I'm planning to introduce her to PC building as well, but I very much identified with your comment, so thank you for providing it, and I hope your daughter gets tons of use for years to come out of her system. One more question from Andy Said IT. Hey, Paul's Hardware, love the channel. Thank you very much. You've been an inspiration and the content you provide speaks volumes. Thank you very much again, that's so kind. I was wondering when you may be getting more of the black hoodies with your logo on it. I had one, but now I can't find it. Timeline or info, and thanks for all the great videos. All right, so I think you're talking about this one. This is the gray version, but the standard Paul's Hardware thumbscrew logo hoodies. My merch, of course, is available over on paulshardware.net. And if we look at hoodies right now, we've got a few available. Got some of the 8-bit designs available. We've got the waterfall design that's pretty cool, but I will definitely be hitting up my merch guy and saying, let's bring some more of this classic design back into stock as well. And what a perfect time to transition over to mail time, where I'm gonna be opening some packages that have arrived, starting with this one. Mail time, yes indeed. If you'd like to send me something to open here on the mail time segment, you can send it to my PO Box, 4325 Diamond Bar, California. I'm fairly excited about this because we're working on some new colors in the store for shirts. So I decided that I was gonna choose a color, and I chose very bright and vivid and colorful brown. There it is, we have a brown color shirt with a beige-ish, maybe light brown logo there. I have a few of these so I can get them washed up and take them along to the Taiwan trip with us. As you maybe can tell, I like earth tones in terms of shirts, but it's not just my preferences that I want to meet, so I have a list of colors in a poll that's linked in the video's description down below. So if you'd like to choose a color you think that would just be really cool to have a shirt in, then vote in that poll, and we're gonna bring some more colors into the store to give some more diversity to the otherwise very classic thumbscrew logo. I like how those turned out. I'm excited to start wearing them. All right, Stephen P sent me something. This one is a mystery. I'm not sure what he sent. Pens. Stephen wrote a very nice note. He and his oldest daughter found several of my videos while they were building their PC. He's been working out and training for the NBC show American Ninja Warrior. He also included some cool ninja stickers and some pens. So what the heck, Steven? Let's give a shout out to Steven Peters, also known as Fire Drill Ninja on YouTube and Instagram, a firefighter, drill sergeant, and ninja warrior. Excellent. Thank you for sending this stuff over, Steven. Thank you for the kind note. And if you make it on the show, I wish you the best of luck. Finally, we got a couple more boxes. These I do know, at least where they're from. I don't think you can see them in this shot, but I have several of our Extra Life placards and things of that nature that have been sent over by Extra Life. And I do believe that these are our awesome hardware placards and stuff like that for our 2023 efforts. We've got a pair of thank you notes I will check out real quick. Aha, I see. One is for the Awesome Hardware team, and the other one is for me directly. So here they are. Did you guys know that Extra Life raised over $11 million in 2023? Thank you to all of you guys who joined our live stream for that and who donated. So this is some artwork done by one of the kids at one of the Children's Miracle Network hospitals. This one has my name on it, so this is the plaque for me, I suppose. And then we also have this one, which is for the Awesome Hardware team, which is me and Kyle, basically. So I guess we'll have to work out some sort of a time-sharing agreement for this, for who gets to display it on their set. But for now, I have it, so it's mine. I love that they send these over, and I like building the collection to remind us of the fundraising that we've done through Extra Life in the past. And it is also a very good reminder that we need to get on the ball and plan stuff for this year. I believe Kyle has already started. He did a live stream, I think, like last month. But I'm going to be seeing him in Taipei at Computex, so we'll discuss that a little bit more, and we'll let you guys know ASAP when the next live stream event is going to be. But that wraps it up for this video and this episode of Probing Paul. Thank you all for the questions you submitted, and a reminder, leave me a comment in the comment section down below if you want me to answer a question next month. Stay tuned, get subscribed for my Computex coverage coming up next week, and of course, check out my store at paulshardware.net. where you can buy awesome merch, including some new t-shirt designs coming really soon. And don't forget to vote in that poll. Thanks again for watching, guys, and we'll see you all in the next video.